You know, in the last month, we have been hearing from literally all over the world. I've been getting emails from New Zealand, Australia, Germany, Great Britain, across the United States. When are we going to get back to understanding the kingdom? Well, your prayers have been answered, because this morning, in this session, we're going to be doing part 10. You know, there's been a lot of changes going on with the ministry, and Mary and I have put in some 10, 12 hours in a day, sometimes just trying to keep up with everything. And there's great opportunity. We begin working with the founder of Livestream.tv that is setting up a site on what they're doing. And we even have the potential, if we can come up with enough programming, to have a 24/7 TV channel, which we're nowhere near ready for yet. But he's also been talking about the need to do maybe some live stream shows. And, you know, I'm looking at all this, and I know we're going to need to upgrade equipment. There's things that we're going to need to get besides maybe sliding it all into a new building. And this morning, you know, even though we have a closed studio here that we try to do praise and worship before I teach, because I think it actually adds, it sets the stage for the teaching of the Word of God. It's so much easier if the anointing's already here to teach. And this morning, if you kind of saw a glazed look, yeah, God says, that's right, kind of a glazed look on my eyes for a little bit, I was sitting there just praising and worshiping. The next thing I know, I was before the throne. And God showed me, because I'm sitting here pondering, you know, there's only so many hours in a day. And how are we going to do everything that we're doing? And then if we go live stream with the podcast, that's going to be a set time every once a week, twice a week that we're doing that. And Mary and I, sometimes we spend a good portion of our day just answering emails. And I'm finally getting to the place where I can actually start writing my next book again. And it's like, God, how am I going to do all this? And God began to show me the next 8 months of it's going to be incremental. Because a lot of things like doing the live stream, we can't do until my next book's done, because there's this literally so many hours in a day. And so as I was sitting there praying and I was before the throne, God just showed me, these are some of the changes you need to make, and this is how incrementally you're going to be able to do some of these things. And the technology has become so much affordable. From what I understand, cheaper than what we paid for that camera. They have a new studio, like television studio quality camera, that tapes in 4D, which is higher definition than high def, for under $2,000. And so as God blesses and those that continue to support us continue to do, we're going to start adding some things. We need some better lighting in here and different things. But I see that, you know, before, when you look at it and look at all that you need to do, it can be so overwhelming. And all God has to do is say, no, you just do it in this order, and you just do it step by step. Oh, by the way, here's some changes you need to make, fat boy, that you because I can't stay 300 pounds. And I told Mary, I said, the way I've been running, I should already be a skinny man. I've got to wear tennis shoes at work because my feet are going all the time just trying to keep up with stuff. But God showed me some things dietary that I need to do, some of the things that we need to do strategic in the ministry. He showed me some more pieces to the puzzle of the book that I'm writing. Now, just in this those few minutes that he showed me that, and any time that you interact with heaven in that higher dimension, it's almost like compressed space, that it may take another week or two for everything that God showed me to kind of unfold within my mind and for me to put all the dots together. But God is up to something. Everybody's looking for dread this September. I'm not. There's an excitement in my spirit. There may be some crazy stuff go on planet Earth, but as far as the remnant is concerned, God is in absolute control. So with that said, in session 9, what we had discovered, in fact, there were a lot of things that we discovered about Nimrod, that Nimrod literally got in the face of God and created a system that would hunt men and draw them away from Almighty God. That is the foundational concept of Babylon. And so the Babylonian system, whether it is a nation or it is a religious system like Mystery Babylon, its prime area, its prime directive, if you will, is to pull men away from God into another system that can replace it. And that system can either be secular or it can be religious, because they are two sides of the same coin. Right. Anything but serving the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right, the way that he prescribed in his word with the revelation of who he is part of the mystery Babylonian system. And it is there so that it's to give man a sense of completeness or even godhood when you go into the secular realm, or serving a God that replaces the God. That's paramount for us to understand. We also discovered that Nimrod altered his DNA and he became a gibberim. Some would call a Nephilim. That he became a giant is what the rabbis, when they translated Genesis 10, and the Septuagint just came out and said, he became a giant. And that's not a mistranslation. It is gigantus in the Greek, in the Septuagint. They knew exactly what he had become. And so he altered himself. And there is a whole plethora of things that can interweave into that. Because when he became something other, it also changed maybe his perception of reality. One of the things that we do know, and I wrote in the Shinar Directive, that there are vortices. There are places that the barriers between the second and third heaven and our reality, there's thin spots. Now, the occult have always known this. That's one of the reasons why on the top of Mount Graham, the Catholic Church built the largest observatory. They knew that there was a portal that they could look into, and actually UFO and all kinds of strange activities have always been there. And Dr. Horn and Chris Putnam had discovered that it was holy to the Indian nation. He thought it was, well, maybe it was a burial site. No, it's not. They have always known that there was a dimensional portal there. So what we're getting into today is dealing with the Tower of Babel. It's very possible that the reason that Nimrod built on the plains of Shinar is that once he became a gibberim, that his acuity expanded. That's what transhumanism is all about, because animals can see things that we can't. You know, that cats can sense or maybe even see when there's a spirit around. That's why witches use them, because they will respond to a familiar, and it basically informs the witch that there's a spirit here. Their visual perception and the different frequencies, infrared and all these different things, they can see. And so it's very possible that when he became, that he was actually able to see and said, okay, this is where I need to build Babel, which literally means the gate of God. That's what Babel means in the original language. So when he built the Tower of Babel, he was building a tower to the gate of God. Paramount for what we're going to be studying today. We also discovered that he was a ruthless and highly intelligent leader, that the two sides of Nimrod perfectly characterize the coming son of perdition, the Antichrist. He is going to be both sophisticated and a barbarian. He is going to be debonair and savage all at the same time. It just depends on how you respond to him is which one you get. That he will propose to be a great builder of society while tearing down everything in his path that doesn't suit him. That's what Nimrod did. In fact, it's kind of summed up, and we quoted this last time from the Jerusalem Targum for Genesis 10 and 9. It says, he was mightily in hunting or in prey and in the sin before God. For he was a hunter of the children of men in their languages, and he said unto them, depart from the religion of Shem. Now, out of the sons of Noah, Shem was the righteous one. It was out of the line of Shem that Messiah came. So depart from the way that was established in Noah, that Shem walked in, the righteous Shem, and cleave to the institutes. So there is a multiplicity, it's not institute, that what Nimrod was doing, he was creating a religious system, a political system, and a financial system that would draw men away from God. Does that sound like Babylon today? You see, while everybody's trying to escape Babylon, this is one of the things that keeps rising up in my spirit. We go into the end of the book of Revelation where it says, come out from among her. It is not a geographical location. It is a system that is religious, political, and financial. We have got to untangle ourselves from the institutes of Nimrod on which all society on this planet is based, unless it is based upon this and this alone. It has Nimrod's tentacles into it. We have got to detangle ourselves because God will judge it all. Where is the safe place you need to be? Exactly where God has commanded you to be. And if that's outside the U.S., God bless you. But one of the things that I'm asking is, where would you go? Is there any place, right now things are crazy in America, but show me a place where they're not worse. You're kind of like jumping out of the frying pan into the fire if you're not careful. Obedience to God is the best place to be. Just wanted to throw that out there. Where are you going, Mike? Like, I'm not going anywhere. God put me on top of this mountain, and on this mountain, I'm going to stay. We may be eventually broadcasting the resistance, but I'm going to stay right here. Because this is where Almighty God, and I can't answer where you're supposed to be. And all those watching on YouTube, I can't tell you where you're supposed to be. You're supposed to hear from God and be obedient. Because each one of us have a strategic place to be in the kingdom of God in the days ahead. And if God tells you to move to Panama or wherever, be obedient. But you've got to hear for you. You can't hear because everybody else is moving. You move. It's where God has placed us. Now, I want to deal today with the Tower of Babel, and this is found in Genesis chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. Because this is actually, we're going to see as this unfolds, that everything that is happening on planet Earth today is reconstruction in another fashion of the Tower of Babel. So much so that when they were creating the EU, the European Union, their symbol was the unfinished Tower of Babel. And God says, uh-huh, ba-boom, boom, ba-boom, boom, boom. Don't you just love it when God gives a sermon sound effects? Yeah. I don't know if that'll come out on video, but every time I get to a good point, it thunders. Starting in verse 1, and the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the valley of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they made brick for stone, and slime about had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make for ourselves a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the earth. Now, one of the things that I have always pondered, now we have already dealt with the size of this city, you know, because as I shared before, before I actually wrote the book, the Shinar Directive, some things you just don't really study out in vivid detail like you would when you're researching a book. I always thought, okay, there's a plain, they got a few huts there, they start piling together a few stones. Babylon, or the city of Babel, was between 100 to 200 square miles. That's several times larger than the city of London. That Nimrod had 12 palaces across this so that he would have a palace within decent distance that he could reside in this one city. That it had a 450-foot wall around the city so large that they could have chariot races, four chariots wide, and still have space for the spectators to watch. And that it was just 30 feet shy of the height of the Great Pyramid of Giza, which was the only edifice on the planet that survived the flood of Noah. And there's evidence that they built the wall that way so that if God would choose to judge them again, that the walls would give them some protection until they could get to something else. It's like daring God, flood the earth again. Interesting, isn't it? And so this tower in the midst of it is not just a few little bricks stacked together that they got three or four stories tall. In fact, in the book of Jubilees, chapter 10 and verse 21, it says this, and they built it 43 years. So they spent 43 years building this thing. Were they building it? And the breadth was 203 bricks, and the height of the brick was the third of one, and its height mounted to 5,433 cubits and two palms, and the extent of the wall was 13 spades, and the other 30 spades. And so you think, well, how big is that? The book of Jubilees basically just said that the Tower of Babel was 8,150 feet. Need to compare that to the Empire State Building, maybe. That's a tall edifice. Now, when I wrote the book of the Shinar Directive, here's some of the things that I found. And I quote, and all of these heights regarding Babel are significant. The only structure to survive the flood of Noah was the Great Pyramid of Giza. Its construction predated the flood by 235 years. The height of the pyramid was 455 feet, and the walls around Babylon were 55 feet short of that height. But the tower, whether you go by the 600 feet as established by one researcher, or the 8,150 feet as recorded in the book of Jubilee, it would have provided an additional refuge if the walls failed to hold back the only judgment that mankind had ever seen, which was the flood. This concept of taking refuge in a tower was also confirmed by the Jewish historian Flavius Josephus, and I quote Josephus here. Nimrod also gradually changed the government into tyranny. Does that sound familiar? Seeing no other way of turning men from the fear of God and to bring them into constant dependence upon his power. That's the essence of tyranny. And it was defined in Nimrod. He also said that he would be revenged on God if he should have a mind to drown the world again, for he had built a tower so high for the waters to be able to reach, and he would avenge himself on God for destroying the forefathers. And so Flavius Josephus, looking at the Tower of Babel, it had two purposes. One as a place of refuge that they could get high enough that not even the floodwaters could reach. Secondly, that if God dared do that, that he was going to get into the third heaven itself and he was going to avenge himself on God. And that Nimrod considered the Nephilim and the Watchers his forefathers. So in the mind of Flavius Josephus, Nimrod had truly become a Gibberine. Now, one of the things I'm kind of playing around with that's going to be in my next book, I have speculated, you know how that animals will have instinct? They don't have to be taught certain things. Like, you know, I've got a Australian shepherd who wants so bad to find something to herd. She herds and she jumps, and then she plays ball to the place of absolute exhaustion because that I don't have a herd for her. But she will try to get out in the pasture next door and herd cattle. She'll try to herd a cat. She'll try to herd grandkids. Because the concept of herding, yeah, she does. The concept of herding and the information and the importance of it is encoded instinctively within her. Well, what's interesting is when you read about the pre-flood, that they had schools, they had universities there, that not only were the Watchers teaching, but so were the Nephilim. And I have speculated that once Nimrod became a Gibborim, the moment he did in that transformation, all the knowledge of the Watchers were encoded into him. He may have found a tablet or something that helped the transformation, but once it happened, all their knowledge was imparted into him. And from that moment forth, according to Josephus, he considered them his forefathers. It gives a whole new definition, because when we Hebraically deal with doctrine, it's not our statement of faith, it's how to live. It's a whole concept of living. And the Apostle Paul says men were heeding to the doctrines of demons. And demons are the disembodied spirit of the Nephilim. Come on, put two and two together. Nimrod was carrying out the way to live that was established by the Watchers and the Nephilim. It was encoded into him. And he would, that was the purpose of the building of Babylon. That was the purpose of the building of the Tower of Babel. Because the Watchers and the Nephilim had unfinished business. He wanted to avenge them against God. Now let's get into the purpose of the building of the Tower of Babel. And I want to read a section of the book of Jasher, because as I read this, bring this back into today, we're going to see many parallels between what Nimrod was doing and the so-called aspirations of a new world order, aspirations of the United Nations. We're going to read out of the book of Jasher, and if you really listen, you're going to begin putting current history with ancient history, because God is telling us the end from the beginning. And I want to pick up here. Where am I at in the book of Jasher? Hold on just a second. It's a couple of pages. The book of Jasher, chapter 8. And I'm going to start with verse 20 for those who like to do research. And King Nimrod reigned securely, and all the earth was under his control. Nimrod was the first one world leader. And all the earth was of one tongue and words of union. And the princes of Nimrod and his great men took counsel together, put Mizraim, Cush, and Canaan in their families. And they said to each other, let us come build ourselves a city, and in it a strong tower, and its top reaching to heaven. And we will make ourselves famed, so that we may reign upon the whole earth, in order that the evil of our enemies may cease from us, and that we may reign mightily over them, and that we may not become scattered over the earth on account of their wars. So Shem and those that were following Shem were constantly interfering and warring against everything that, in other words, Shem represented the remnant, and what was going on in Babel represented the mystery Babylonian religion. And so we're going to have to do all this so that we can silence them and they will quit interfering with what we're doing. So guys, for those who considered remnant, we have just found what our purpose in the earth is. We're the resistance to Babylon. And they all went out before the king, and they told the king these words, and the king agreed with them in this affair, and he did so. And all the families assembled, consisting of about 600,000 men, and they went to seek an extensive place of ground to build the city and the tower. Well, it's 200 square miles. It had to be pretty extensive, didn't it? And they sought in the whole earth, and they found none other, one valley on the east in the land of Shinar, about a 2 days' walk, and they journeyed there, and they dwelt there. And they began to make bricks, burn in fire, to build a city and the tower that they had imagined to complete. So there was something happening in this unification around evil that they all came together and they imagined, and Psalms 2 says they imagined a vain thing. Okay? We see that they always come back to plan A, no matter what. The Watchers, the Nephilim, the kingdom of darkness always comes back to their basic plan. Now picking up here in verse 25, And the building of the tower was unto them a transgression and a great sin, and they began to build it. And whilst they were building against the Lord God of heaven, they imagined in their hearts to war against him and to ascend into heaven. So they imagined in their hearts that they were going to be able to actually go into the third heaven to war against God himself, which actually adds credence to what God said in Genesis, that whatever they had imagined and purposed in their heart, they were going to be able to do. You see, there's more there than them building a skyscraper. And all these people, all the families divided themselves into three parts. The first said, we will ascend into heaven and fight against him, Almighty God. The second said, we will ascend into heaven and place our own gods there and serve them. And the third said, we will ascend into heaven and smite him with bows and spears. And God knew all their works and all their evil thoughts, and he saw the city and the tower which they were building. So that was their purpose, was to not only draw all men away from God, but that wasn't enough. They wanted to be able to basically, and I'm not going to read the rest of this because we know what God did. Now, I like the book of Jasher. It said that God got really ticked off at that. So he sent lightning, blew up the first one-third. The ground opened up and swallowed one-third. And one-third was kind of still stuck in the ground saying, don't you ever do this again. You know, kind of like Sodom and Gomorrah. But they're going to do it. Now, one of the key things, many researchers, Dr. Tom Horn, Steve Quayle, and many others, have always speculated that the Tower of Babel was more than a tower, that it was a portal generator. In fact, one guy that understands alien craft, the scientist that does all this stuff, says that a ziggurat, the way that it was shaped, actually not only could serve as a dimensional portal, but also take the electromagnetic energy that comes with that for a vehicle going through it. They actually that is where there's the old movie Stargate, the original movie, where they said pyramids were actually landing pads for the spacecraft of the gods. They actually got that concept from the research that was done, I believe, on the Tower of Babel. Now, one of the things in my upcoming book that I'm getting ready to reveal is I have tried to unify super string theory with its 11 dimensions with the Bible, in which I can show how the second heaven, third heaven is in hyperspace, hell or Sheol, and the bottomless pit are in dimension zero, what we would call subspace. And I got the perfect title for one chapter of the book, The Creatures from Dimension Zero. Kind of sounds like an old 50s horror film. But we need to understand that if this is true, that he was creating it, I believe that what CERN is doing. Now this year, they crank up the power. Before, all these were tests. And many within the scientific community are saying, don't create many black holes, because if you lose control of it, the whole planet gets sucked in and then there's no more Earth. And so they tested it and said, ha ha, it didn't. But they know what they're trying to do. They've actually come out and said that these are actually opening up portals to hyperspace, to these other spatial dimensions within our universe that are beyond our perception. And we need to realize this, the concept of this, and I go back to Josh Peck, who has really thought this stuff through. If we could add one spatial dimension to our three plus, I believe that the temporal dimension actually runs all of them, which is really frightening, because when you get up to the higher, I think to move in higher spatial dimensions, you have to resonate closer to the speed of light, because God is light. So when you get that, It actually mathematically works out that if you have beings that are functioning at 99.9% of the speed of light, 1,000 years is a day and a day is 1,000 years. Because it changes how you interact with the temporal dimension. And then we come down to where we are, and a day to us is like a day. You know what's frightening? You move down the chain into dimension zero, and it may be the other way around. You want to add a whole dimension, a new dimension to being in hell? That one day on earth is like 1,000 years there. That's just crazy freaky, isn't it? But the math there, because they're further away from the speed of light and into darkness. And so they were trying to come up with a way, and even CERN is saying this, that we may be able to send messages into these higher dimensional realities. And one of the things that I have been speculating, because we're beginning to see more UFO activity, we're beginning to see more manifestations of other things. There has been a report that the last time before they did all the repair to the CERN, they cranked up the power and something shorted out. And when it did, all along Switzerland, there were reports of people seeing giants kind of come out of nowhere and then just disappearing with that surge. I believe one of the things that they're doing as they're doing these experiments, there are certain mechanisms. When Adam and Eve fell, that he separated, it separated this first, second, and third heaven. The occult have always known there are certain times of the year, like on All Hallows Eve, where that barrier between the first and second heaven are thinner. Well, maybe these experiments are thinning the veil. And what's going to happen when they begin completely cranking up? They may actually one day destroy the veil between the first and second heaven, which we kind of see implications of that in the book of Revelation. What's really interesting, you can go back and listen to Hagman and Hagman, and this has had Tom Horn and Steve Quayle on it, and they were talking about the Nephilim and CERN. And Tom shares an event where he had just done AM Coast to Coast, which is one of those ones that starts at midnight and goes to like 3 o'clock in the morning. And so after he did that show, God bless you, Tom, for you doing it. I don't know if I'd ever necessarily want to stay up that late. I'm a 9 o'clock kind of guy. I go to bed at 9, get up at 6. He did the show, and after he got off the show, he went and checked his email. And there was a email from somebody working in the museum in Iraq, and gave him a secret location into their intranet, which is usually just used within the museum itself, and a username and a password. And so here it is, 4 o'clock in the morning. Well, I might as well go check this out before I go to bed. And there's all these photographs, and it was after we invaded Iraq, and we're there, we've taken over the country. And you have leaders in the U.S. being escorted into the museum in Iraq. But it was what was not on display that they were interested in. And so they go through in the back, and there's pictures of all the... because where Babylon was, the original Babylon, and the Tower of Babel, Saddam Hussein had done excavations there. Archaeological excavations. And so you have all this stuff that the public hadn't seen, of all these idols of solid gold, solid silver, priceless heirlooms. They walked right past them like they didn't even exist. And what they were interested in were two huge crates, probably two times the size of this pulpit, that were sitting in the back. And he said, in the video, I couldn't see what they were, but he said, they passed up, can you imagine, 6 foot, 8 foot solid statues of pure gold. They passed up like it was nothing. And military personnel wanted what was in those crates. And then Steve Quayle jumps on and says, well, you want to know the rest of the story, because he actually has 2-3-4-star generals call and will tell him things. He says, you want to know what those were? And Tom says, yeah, I'd like to know what they were. And he said, they were out of the what was left of the Tower of Babel, which was a portal generator and its power source. May very well have been one of the reasons why we went into Iraq to begin with. It was about oil. It was about the remains of Gilgamesh, which was a Nephilim, so they could get his DNA. And it was very possibly about what Saddam Hussein had found in the excavations. And so now they very well may have the ancient device that was in the Tower of Babel to open up a portal generator built upon Watcher technology. Doesn't this set your mind abuzz with possibilities? What was is going to be again. Now we need to understand the very spirit and the nature of Babylon. Mystery Babylon always creates a system that hunts men, draws them away from God. We see that but once that's done, you see there's an end game with the one world government. There's an end game with climate, you know, this whole thing of climate control is one of the biggest piles of horse manure I have ever heard in my life. Before they were saying, you know, climate warming, before it was climate warming, it was climate cooling. Now they've just turned it to climate change, because the earth is actually beginning to cool back down because our sun is getting ready to enter into a dormant state. What they didn't tell you, as the earth was heating up, so was Mars, so was Mercury, so were all the other planets in our solar system, because the sun itself was in a very active mode, which means it creates more heat. But it's all about controlling the earth and taxing us into oblivion. But once Nimrod got control, after he did that and has a majority of the people in its control, he will always move to attack heaven itself. That's the purpose behind CERN. That's the purpose behind finding the God particle. In fact, I found an interesting quote this week from Tesla. Because, you know, all this stuff on physics and all things that they prove that there's not a God and all this always comes down to mathematical equations. And Tesla said the problem with scientists today is they have abandoned experimentation for mathematics. And he said, so they move from equation to equation until they end up not even remotely near reality. And I kind of wonder if that's possibly what we're seeing today. But we see, what I want to share is there is a connection we find in the Tower of Babel, the future aspirations that are manifested in the book of Revelation. And this is found in Revelation chapter 16, verses 12 through 6. And it said, the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits come up out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. And they were the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them together to battle of the great day of God Almighty. So here we achieve, they achieve basic control of the planet, and the guy says, okay, you got your comeuppance coming, go ahead and gather your army. And it said, behold, I came as a thief, blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see a shame. So this is saying, listen, when the whole earth is following the Antichrist, you better make sure you're following the Christ, not the Antichrist. And the thing is here to keep your garments, to walk in biblical holiness as this day approaches. Now look what it says here. And he gathered them together in the place called, in the Hebrew tongue, Armageddon. You see, the crown of the Antichrist's reign, which I believe is actually going to flourish for 3.5 years. He's going to get the exact same time as Jesus got when Jesus was ministering. And guys, don't email me and try to tell me that Jesus' ministry was only a year. That dog won't hunt, although it's been going through the Hebraic Roots movement. It is based upon error. Jesus' ministry was 3.5 years because he walked out the Torah cycle that as was originally given by Moses, which was a 3.5 year cycle. There are too many connectors in the Word of God that when you place them with the Gospels, it was a 3.5 year thing. Because if you follow that he had to be a lamb of the first year, that means that Jesus didn't have a ministry because he was already 30 years old before he even began ministry. You can't blend these things without a proper exegesis in place. We need to understand that the end game, that once the Antichrist takes over everything and controls the whole world, he is going to create something that is going to make him believe that he can go into the third heaven itself with this transeugenic horde, that he is going to build this greatest army that the earth has ever seen, so that he can finish what Nimrod started, because the Tower of Babel did not destroy the work of Nimrod. That became the Shinar Directive that the esoteric societies have been working since the time of Nimrod to complete. And it will always end on war against God himself. That they enter into the Valley of Armageddon with the expectation of fighting against God himself. It's not just about destroying Israel. It's about destroying the God of Israel. And when the dimensional portal opens, if you've read the back of the book, Jesus comes through on a white horse with all the saints behind him, but we don't have to lift a sword because they forgot with Almighty God, the one that's in the beginning of the book, that spoke the universe into existence. The Bible says everything in our universe is upheld by the word of his power. That means it only takes a word to disintegrate it. That there's a two-edged sword that comes out of his mouth and destroys this great horde that's been assembled. So when they finally get their generator operational, what they don't realize is that Jesus and the armies of heaven are already waiting on the sill of heaven to step over into this what we call normal space to finally put this forever, settling this conquest. You open this thing to destroy me, and I'm here to destroy you. The important lesson here, guys, that that I want to take from all this, because what we see is Nimrod had his plan. He had his army. It's very possible he had to have Nephilim or these Gibberim. In fact, there's evidence in both the writings of the rabbis and in the apocryphal books that he not only hunted men, he hunted giants to bring them under his control and used them for his construction. That's how you get a city 200 miles square when you don't have cranes and you don't have all the big earth-moving equipment. You have giants. That's how you get a 450-foot tall wall built, or a 400-foot wall built. You use giants. That's how you get a tower that's over 8,000 feet tall built. You use giants. And now he had a giant army, and he was ready to move against God. He had his timetable. This is prophetic significance. He had his timetable. But as he was begin implementing his timetable, God came down to judge his timetable, and now it's been on hold for over 5,000 years. The lesson that we can learn, guys, is that the elite have their plans for what they want to do on planet Earth, but let me tell you something. Their timetable is not in their hands. It's in the hands of Almighty God. And they will progress as Almighty God allows them to progress to fulfill Bible prophecy. It's in his hands. He can frustrate it at any given moment or any given geographical location for his purposes. Now, do things in America need to be judged? Yes. But the question that I need to ask you is, can God judge the ungodly while protecting the righteous? That's a truth that runs from Genesis to Revelation. So our question is not just about having long-term food storage, stocked up. Because if you're not right with God, you just hand it to the enemy and go hungry. The quintessential thing, besides all these other things to prepare, is you got to make sure that you're right with Jesus, that you're untangled from Babylon, and that the devil has nothing in you. That means the first thing you need to do is not run to the store. It means you need to hit your knees and repent and return to biblical ways. It means that you're going to have to question everything that you do in your life and say, does it stem from the word of God or does it flow from Babylon? And let me tell you something, they have spent 5,000 years entangling everything that we do into Babylonian ways. They can give, and the Catholic Church is very good at giving it a Christian name and a Christian veneer, but it's still Babylon by any other name. go back to the origin of anything. That is its purpose. That is its spiritual power. And when you do and you discover its origin, if it's not of God, if it stems from the Valley of Shinar, you better repent of it and set it down, never to go back to it again. Because one of the things, as I have been studying this and putting this together, what keeps on coming back is a warning of Jesus to the Pharisees. I mean, they were hot after his, you know, after him about something, and he turned to them and said, remember Lot's wife. Even while she was being delivered from Sodom and Gomorrah, she looked back in longing. The tyranny of the familiar. I understand that. I know what to expect of that. And I have allowed part of that to become who I am. The task of the remnant is to examine ourselves. The Bible says if a man judges himself, he will have that no need for no man to judge him. I need to judge myself, and I need to begin untangling myself out of Babylon to prepare for the days ahead. That is more important than long-term storage food. That is more important than a backup generator. Now, I'm not saying you don't need to get those things if God's telling you to get them. What I am telling you is you better do part one first, or part two isn't going to matter worth a hill of beans. Come on now. You could be armed to the teeth like you were a small division of the special forces. But if God's not on your side, you've already lost. You could walk with God. Five stones and a sling will take down a Nephilim. Come on now. Let's bring this thing back in balance. If God be for us, who can be against us? But Jack, you better make sure that you're in God's camp completely and you don't have one foot in Babylon and one foot in the kingdom of God, because I'm going to prophesy to you right now that there is a 500-foot fence post cast out of the iron of Babylon that's going to hit you square right down the middle. You either get on one side or the other. We're getting ready to enter into a Mount Carmel experience. If God be God, serve him. If Baal be God, serve him. But Jack, you better make up your mind. You better get in one camp or the other. Because you don't have the luxury anymore of being in one foot or the other. Because if you have one foot in Babylon, it will suck you in. But you have to choose to pull yourself out. And it's going to take some prayer, it's going to take some fasting, it's going to take some research, and it's going to take some repentance. And this is not warning, oh, Dr. Lake is talking about something, I got 10 years, you got a couple of months, Jack, before the prophecy starts hitting the fan to one degree or another, and you better make sure that both feet are in the kingdom of God. You see, this is a pep talk. This is me saying, you know what? If you were ever going to get off the fence and walk with God, it better be right now. If you were ever going to change your life and get right with God completely and surrender completely to the cross, you better do it right now. Because what you do now will determine where you're getting ready to go, not only in this life, but in the life to come. Because one of the most dangerous things, you know, when communism took over Russia, communism took over China. Do you know what the greatest threat to the body of Christ were? It wasn't the communist dictators. It was former members of the body of Christ that left the ways of God and got swallowed up by that Babylonian system. Because they knew how they talked, they knew how they walked, and they knew their ways, and they knew their meeting places. And they began to betray Christian after Christian after Christian. Don't get sucked into the ways of Babylon. Yield to the kingdom of God. That's why I'm teaching this, so that you can differentiate between one kingdom and another. Nimrod's institutes will always destroy your walk with God and pull you into another kingdom, the kingdom of Lucifer himself. Well, Father, I ask today, in the name of Jesus, Father, I ask for a dose of spiritual testosterone to hit every man. Father, to knock off the spirit of slumber, to knock off this apathy towards spiritual things. Father, I curse that apathy right now in the name of Jesus, and I command it to leave every man who names the name of Christ. And Father, let us be endued with power from on high to walk in the things of God, to shake off Babylon out of our families, out of our marriage, out of our finances, out of our religion, Father, out of everything. And let us stand, men and women, side by side, united in Christ Jesus and united in the statutes, the commandments, and the ways of God, which are the very basis for how the kingdom of God functions. Father, give us a fresh anointing to destroy hell itself in our lives and to walk solely in your kingdom, I ask. In the name of Jesus, I ask it.